my people to seek me. Obey him and obey his word and walk in holiness. He is not taking anything less than holiness and righteousness. Because the reason why we are not getting where we need to be is because we are not living according to how God wants us to live. And there are things that God has told us through his word, but we have not done it. So as the message comes through, ask God. It is always good when a word is given, go and ask God, where do I need to correct myself? Or where do I need to make it right with you? Ask God questions. He loves when you ask questions. My last message I preached about, as the foundation is shaking, your prison doors will be opened. This building has a foundation. If you shake the foundation, the whole building will go down. I wonder if somebody went ahead and asked God, what prison am I in? Because ever since I preached that message, I feel God bringing that message in my mind. So that was a word for somebody. And then something I say, go and worship and praise God for 7 days. And something will happen in your life. Maybe it requires you to worship and praise God. Then your doors will be opened. Did anybody follow up with God? What prison you are in? Honestly, did anybody follow up with God? Because when God speaks, he wants you to follow up and ask God, what prison am I in? Why am I still stuck in this place? Because there's a reason. Yeah. And there are deeper things that God will not reveal to somebody else because they concern you. They concern your background. They concern your foundation. But if the word of God, if God speaks and you don't respond to that word, then you stay in the same place. Like the children of the Israelites, they stayed in the wilderness for 40 years instead of 15 days because they didn't hear the word of God. They disobeyed God. So ask yourself, when the word is preached here, do you follow up with God? I followed up with God. Because as I was preaching to you, I was preaching to myself. And God took me to the prison I am in a dream. So he revealed to me because I followed up. And he's bringing out. He's bringing me out of that prison. So it is very important. Don't just come to church, listen to the message, and then walk away. Because the person who is standing here, they are standing here on behalf of God, giving you a message, directing you, giving you instruction on how to get to your promised land. Let us go to the book of Amos, chapter 9. Amos, chapter 9. As I was going through this message, at first I thought it is a very harsh message. But then as I continued to seek God and allow the Holy Spirit to minister, I could sense a lot of love and desire for God to bring his people to his side. In holiness and obedience. Now read. And I saw the Lord standing by the altar, and he said, strike the doorposts that the threshold may shake, and break them on the heads of them all. I will slay the last of them with the sword. He who flees from them shall not get away, and he who escapes from them shall not be delivered. Though they dig in hell, from there my hand shall take them. Though they climb up the heaven, from there I will bring them down. And though they hide themselves on top of Carmel, from there I will search and take them. Though they hide from my sight at the bottom of the sea, from there I will command the serpent and it shall bite them. Though they go into captivity before their enemies, from there I will command the sword, and it shall slay them. I will set my eyes on them for harm and not for good. The Lord God of hosts, he touches the earth and it melts, and all who dwell there mourns. All of it shall swell like a river and subside in the rivers of Egypt. We go to verse 8. Behold, the eyes of the Lord God are on the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy from the face of the earth I will not utterly destroy the house of Jacob, says the Lord. For surely I will command and will seed the house of Israel among the nations, as the grain is seed in a sieve. Yet not the smallest grain shall fall to the ground. All the sinners of my people shall die by the sword, who say the calamity shall not overtake nor confront us. On that day I will raise up a tabernacle of David, which has fallen, and repair the damages. I will raise up its ruin, and will rebuild it as in the days of the old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom, and all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who does these things. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when the plowman shall overtake the reapers, and the treaders of grain, he who sows the seed. The mountains shall drip from sweet wine, and all the hills shall overflow. I will bring back the captives of my people Israel, and shall rebuild the waste cities and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyard and drink wine from them. They shall also make gardens and eat from them. I will plant them in their land, and no longer shall they be pulled up from the land I have given them, says the Lord. When I was reading through verse 1, it says, I saw the Lord standing by the altar, and he said, strike the pots. So the Lord had brought judgment on the people of Israel, and he started at the altar. The altar of Baal was a place of worship for the Israelites. And I was asking myself, why is it that the Lord is starting judgment from the altar, from where forgiveness should start? Because usually in the altar of worship, in the altar of the house of God, there we find forgiveness. But in this verse it says the Lord was standing at the altar. This time he was bringing judgment to his own people. And he's saying from the verse, none of them will escape. And I was wondering, what did they do that the Lord wanted to destroy his own people? If you remember the history of the children of the Israelites, God delivered them from the land of Egypt and brought them to the promised land as his people. God delivered the children of Israelite because he wanted them to represent him among other nations as God. But what happened, the Israelites, from the time they got to the wilderness until the time they got to the promised land, they disobeyed God. They never followed the laws that were given. They took up the character, the behavior of other nations that they met in the promised land, and they met on the way. And they forgot that God chose them to represent him to other nations. They were special people and were supposed to behave in a certain way. They were supposed to be ambassadors. Just like us, the way we are supposed to be ambassadors. We are supposed to be ambassadors of Christ. Wherever we go, through our character, through our behavior. But there's something that really God was pulling out of the message. And as I was going back to the book of Amos, the reason why really God was judging them this time is because of how they relate with each other. How they related with each other as brothers and sisters. Because during this time, Israel and Judah had become very rich. They had conquered a lot of financial districts. And the rich were living very luxurious. And they were selling the poor. They were oppressing the poor. They were their brothers and sisters. That this is why God was so much upset. And they did not repent. It was all about relationship. How they were treating each other. And in the book of Amos, it is the only book in the Bible where God talks about is really fed up of the way the Israelites were treating each other as brothers and sisters. Because God expected, and according to the commandments given to Moses, God had of even the poor needed to be treated. And God is speaking to the church this evening. The way we relate with each other, the way we represent God, whether in your office, whether in your relationship with each other, God wants to see a change. He's giving us a chance to change the way we relate, the way we see each other. And there's something that really in Amos 2, 11 and 12. If you read Amos 2, it will show you all the things that God was not happy with. I raise up your sons as prophets, and some of your young men as Nazarites. Is it not so, O you children of Israel, says the Lord? But you give the Nazarites wine to drink, and commanded the prophets, saying, do not prophesy. Here God is warning the Israelites. He had chosen some of the children, though God had separated them. A Nazarite is a person who God gives instruction, like Samson, from the stomach of their mother. God had put in them because he had consecrated them for certain purpose in the nation of Israel. But the parents and the fathers and even the church in general, they never nurtured those gifts. And they became defiled. So God could not use them. They were not fruitful. The church is calling us, the Lord is calling us this evening as a church. Among us, there are gifts that God has put in his people. In the body of Christ, no one seems to care about those people or those gifts that God has put in the lives of his people. God wants to nurture, encourage those gifts and calling among his people to be nurtured up so that God can use them. Because you never know, somebody is sitting here, God has called them to be a voice for nations. But because no one is nurturing that gift, or no one has the time to nurture that gift, then those gifts are not becoming fruitful in the body of Christ. And God is calling the body of Christ this evening to nurture, to be more interested, the way we relate with each other, the way we socialize. We are brothers and sisters. And God is asking us, be more concerned. Don't be so self-centered, self-ambition, self-righteousness. The Israelites were more concerned about the feasts, going to the shrine, prayers, but they neglected charity and serving others. And the Lord rejected their sacrifice. He said, I have rejected your sacrifice. I have rejected your worship. I have rejected your offerings. Because spiritual things and natural things and physical things, they are all supposed to go together. Most of us, we put value on prayers and preaching and teaching. But God wants us to combine prayers, preaching, and teaching with service, serving others. Because most of us, we lack the spirit of servanthood. That's what is calling each one of us. Because God has put the gifts in us. We are already prospered spiritually. You are in a position to help somebody up, but you are not doing it. God is calling on each one of us. Do not neglect whatever God has put inside of you each year. That is your prosperity. And you're supposed to use it to nurture those who are still growing up. They give. There are people connected to you. There are people that God has connected to you. But because of the things we are going through in life, maybe you don't have enough time to extend a hand of help to those people and to nurture them, to follow up with them so that they can be fruitful in the kingdom of God. Praise God. Praise God again. Praise God again. as you nurture them, as you use the prosperity, whatever God has put in you. You see, the rich people, they never extended their hand to the poor. They sold out the poor. Whatever riches that God has given us is the spiritual richness, spiritual prosperity. They are things, they are gifts to each one of us that God has put inside of you. So God wants us to extend our hand to those who are poor spiritually. And I thank God for the ministry of evangelism that has already started in this church, because that is what God is calling us to do. We are not supposed to stay in the four walls of the church, pray and preach to each other. After we pray and preach to each other, we are supposed to go out there and share whatever God has given us with the poor. That is why God was bringing judgment to the children of the Israelites. Praise God. Praise God again. I thank God for Samson, and I thank God for God bringing him into this ministry, because he has a spirit of nurturing. I would say through my contact with Samson, there are some things that God has revived, that has erupted in me that were not there. I really thank God for the spirit of nurturing, and I pray that God will continue to use you. And each one of us, we need to follow that. We need to adapt whatever he has. Whichever way you can nurture, you're supposed to represent God in your office, in your workplace. You're supposed to be an ambassador. If an ambassador of the United States come in this place, you will know. You don't need to be told he's an ambassador of the United States. Because what ambassadors do, they represent the country. As we represent the kingdom of God, does your behavior, does your character, represent the kingdom of God? An ambassador speaks the language of the country, the culture, the way of life. He walks like them, confidence. And when he goes to represent the country, you will know. Because he represents the country very well, because he had been sent to represent that country. So ask yourself this evening, are you representing the kingdom of heaven? Are you walking in righteousness and holiness? Or are you just like any other person in the office? God is calling us to align whatever in your life, because God wants righteousness and holiness, nothing else. Not small sin, not big sin. We have to be aligned with the will and the purpose of God for our lives. Wherever you go, you don't need to tell anybody I'm a Christian. You don't even need to talk. But your actions, the way you talk, the way you walk, it will just represent who you are. And that is how people will be attracted to this God that you serve. And there are some things that you are hindering in your life by walking in ways that does not represent God. The Lord says, I will see. I will see means this is awareness. I will see every impurity in our lives. He is going to remove every impurity. He's done begging. He's done telling. He's done it. It is a time, because it's something that God wants to accomplish. And he doesn't want any stumbling block to what he wants to do. He will bring judgment if we don't align ourselves with the will and the purpose of God. Because when God wants to do something in his kingdom, if you become a stumbling block, he will move you on the side. Because there's somebody that, there's a life that God wants to change. And our God is very faithful. He's so loving because he gives us a chance to change our ways. So this evening, ask yourself, in which area of my life, do I need to align myself? Maybe been speaking to you about charity, helping the work of God, doing something in the kingdom of God. He has been instructing you to do charity for orphans or whatever. Have you done it, or you're still procrastinating? Because God says, whenever He speaks, we need to obey the word of God. Days are gone when He used to tell you 1, 2, 3. It's a time to mature up as Christians and listen to the word of God and follow instruction. He says in Psalms 32:8, I will instruct you, I will guide you in the way that you should go. And down there He says, don't be like a mule. A mule is the one that wants to be pulled because you have refused. It is a high time. There's something that God wants to do in this place. But it shall only be done when we align ourselves, not only in this house, but in the kingdom of God. Because we have become so intermarried with the world. Just like the children of the Israelites. They became so intermarried with other nations. They adapted their characters. They adapted their behaviors, their idolatry, oppression of the poor. And you could not differentiate them from other nations. But God is calling for righteousness and holiness in the body of Christ. God is not coming for a defiled church. He's coming for a church that has been purified. And I've been asking God, as I was being given this message, I was asking God, show me which areas. Because I desire to walk in righteousness. I desire to be rooted and grounded in the promised land. What are areas that I need to change? What are areas that does not align me with your will? What have I not obeyed? Ask yourself, where do you need to align yourself? When God brought us in this country, He did not bring us just to work. Have you ever asked God, what is your purpose in this country? Why did you bring me in this country? Because maybe the reason why God brought you here is to bring the Gentiles to Christ. But we have done nothing. Ask God, why did you bring me in this country? What am I not doing that I should be doing? In your place of work, are you representing God? Where I work, I talk with a lot of people, and most of them, they were brought up in families where they do not know Christ. So my prayer has been, God, force me. Holy Spirit, force me. Force me to talk to them and bring in my path people who are accepted to Christ. And I've seen God, whatever you ask from God, He will do it for you, as long as it's for His kingdom. There are so many people that are out there. They need to hear that. They've never heard. Some of them, I talk to them, they ask me, who is Jesus? They want to know more. And ask God for wisdom to talk to them. I make sure every day, I tell the Holy Spirit, help me to change my life in that light. Help me to talk to somebody. Bring to somebody in my life who needs to be encouraged. And the people I talk to, if you listen to their stories, we need to put more effort. We need to arise as Christians. You know God. You have been taught the word of God. You know who Christ is. You read the Bible every day. But there is no way you're changing the world. You're not changing anything wherever you are. God is calling us to arise. Because if we arise, God is... I never knew it was possible for me to go preaching on the flights. But God gives me favor. There is always an angel protecting that when I speak to them, I will have favor. And nothing will happen because it's so many... You just do it in wisdom. people who are hurting in this country. It is up to us. God is calling us, arise. We must arise. We must arise, starting with the way we treat each other. Starting the way we nurture the gifts that God has brought into the house. We have become so self-centered, self-ambition. But God wants us to go out there. Forget about yourself for one moment. Because most of us, we only see our storm. The storm we are going through is all that matters in our lives. But there is somebody who is going through a bigger storm than us. If you could only get out of your storm and focus on Jesus, because when you are in the storm, it's very hard for you to focus on Christ. Because in the storm, you will not see God. Because you wonder, why is this happening to me? If God is for real, why am I going through this? He's still in your storm. And the minute you get out of your storm, start focusing on Christ. Then He will give you answers. He will clear the storm for you. And the best way for you to grow is to touch somebody's life, nurture somebody. Be concerned about that somebody who is hurting, a fellow Christian, a gentile, a person who is really hurt inside, or they're wondering where is the way out. God is saying we must arise. Our actions, the way we do things, the way we walk, we must represent Him as ambassadors of Christ. We must represent Christ. Righteousness and holiness. Righteousness and holiness is what God is asking. Because maybe it's that behavior or whatever you are doing that is holding you from your promised land. That is holding you from that which you have been believing God for. You can come to church, we can pray for you. We will pray for you. But there is that part which I cannot pray for you. It's only you that can get yourself out. We will pray for you. We will anoint you from morning to evening. But there is that part that which you should pray. Because God is waiting you to move in the right direction. And then your life will change. Ask God. Have conversations with God. It is not rocket science. It's like the way you speak with your dad. He's the same. We complicate it. Ask God. I always ask God and He reveals. Where do you want me to change? Where do you want me to align myself? But there is that step that you should make. Whatever God reveals, ask, tell God, reveal to me my heart. What is inside of me that is hindering me from righteousness and holiness? What is it that is inside me that is keeping me from you, Lord? And He will reveal Himself to you. Seek God. The Lord was saying to me, tell my people to seek me. Spend time with God. Read the word. Because it is when you read the word and you pray that you receive answers. And God redirects and roots your life. There are some things that will never go out of the family line, out of the generation, until somebody decides to see God, walk in righteousness, walk in holiness, desire to be like Jesus. Because we are created in the image of God.
Hallelujah.
And we are changed every day to be the image of Christ. God wants to do something in your life. But if you hear the word of God tonight, change your ways. Whatever it is, come close to God. Because the pastor will want to do whatever you're asking for. But God requires your commitment. God requires you to play your part. In whichever area that God has called you, God wants to see you actively involved in the things of the kingdom. Actively involved in the things of the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom of God. All other things God has given us, they have already been given. All spiritual blessings, they belong to us. But you need to first seek the kingdom of God. Put God first in your life. If you put God second in your life, things will not move in your life because you are leading yourself. But if you put God first in your life, He will be leading you to the direction and He wants you to go. May the Lord help us. May the Lord give us a deeper understanding. A deeper understanding of what He desires us to do. Because maybe you are the one that God is. Maybe this message is for you tonight to be able to deliver your family from whatever is eating your family, from whatever is happening in your family. Ask yourself, Lord, which part do I need to play? How do you want me to represent you? How do you want my walk with you to be? And as God reveals it to you, make the right steps to change. Because He says, my judgment, none will escape. In our case, He may not come down like in the altar. But there are things that will be happening in your life because you have walked away from God, because you have disobeyed. And you will wonder what happened to my life. Because He says, He is omnipresent, He is everywhere. Even when you are alone, even in your thoughts, in your hearts, He knows what you are thinking. There is nothing you can hide from God. Whatever it is, and whatever you think might have been keeping away from righteousness and holiness, it is a high time to tell God to reveal it to you so that change can come to your life. Change can come in your family because He promises restoration. As you seek forgiveness and you align yourself with the will of God, our God is faithful. He's going to restore everything. That you have lost. If you read from 11 to 15, God promises restoration. Restoration of fellowship. Because when He says strike the doorpost, then the threshold may shake. It means broken fellowship. Because of disobedience, rebellion, walking against the will of God. But then the Lord says, if you repent, if you align yourself with the will of God, He's going to restore you. And restore everything that the enemy has stolen from you. There will be coming a time of restoration. That you will have enough harvest. You will have an overflow. Our God is faithful. He's so faithful. Whenever He gives a promise, He fulfills it. And whenever you walk in righteousness, He will continue to ask.